Good morning, church. Good morning, Pastor Riley. How are you?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing well. Look at how long your hair is getting.
I know.
My goodness. This pandemic's been going on for a while.
Mm-hmm.
It's good to see you.
It's good to see you as well. It's been a minute.
It has. Friends, it is good to see all of you who are joining us this morning. From all over the country. Thank you for spending this time with us. It is an honor and a privilege to be pastors in this virtual space. Friends, I'm going to invite you to look around where you are. To just look around. If you have a window nearby, look out your window. I just saw a bird fly to a tree near mine. If you have somebody near you watching this with you, look at them. Make some meaningful eye contact. And friends, I want us to remember that all spaces are sacred. That while our church sanctuary is, of course, incredibly sacred to us and incredibly special to us, where you are is sacred as well. So let's take a deep breath and prepare ourselves for worship. Please join with me in our call to worship. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure.
For every mountain, there is a miracle of fear conquered.
We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you.
For every mountain, there is a miracle of potential realized.
You were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within you. It's not just in some, it's in everyone. And as you let your own light shine, you unconsciously give other people permission to do the same.
Our empowering presence moves mountains and liberates others to their highest aspirations.
Join with me in our prayer of confession. You call us and we ignore your whisper, listening to the voices of this world. You call us and we choose a different path, following our own devices. You call us to be your voice in this world, to be your hands in this world, to be your feet in this world, to proclaim your peace, your comfort, forgiveness, healing, love, and grace. Forgive us. Open our ears, call us again, and use us. Friends, the God who created us, who remains on listening and speaking terms with us through all circumstances, who opens the future to us, abounds with forgiving love. Receiving it, we can proclaim with joy.
All thanks and glory be to God.
And friends, since we have been forgiven in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us use our chat box to share the peace with one another. Lots of people are remarking at how sunny it is out, how nice it is to see the sun shining. I hope wherever you are that the sun is shining. Is it shining out in Schuylerville, Pastor Riley?
Oh yeah.
Oh good. Good, good, good.
Hopefully it is shining in Utah and in Florida and in South Carolina, and wherever folks are today.
Absolutely. And I hope people all got to see our chat box. I think we've had over 50 people just wish one another peace. All right, friends, let us continue with our service of worship with our children's message.
Good morning, friends. This morning, I would like to tell you a true story from when I was a kid. I very clearly remember that I was the last person in my class to learn how to tie my shoes. I tried really hard and I just felt like my fingers didn't work or I wasn't smart enough and I just couldn't get the loop and the find the other loop and to pull and I remember the feeling of being frustrated. I had this piece of wood that was cut out like the shape of a shoe and had real shoelaces in it. And I would sit on the living room floor and I would practice on that wooden shoe to try to learn how to do the tie. And my brother was playing with Legos and my dad would like read the paper. And I felt like I had to do homework of trying to learn how to tie a shoe. And I would get so frustrated. I'd want to throw that shoe across the room, but in my house, throwing wasn't allowed, and I'm guessing in your house is not allowed either. And here's the thing I want you to know. I can tie my shoes now. In fact, I have tied some of your shoes, which I don't mind doing. And when I was learning how to do it, I felt like I would never be able to, that I would be wearing Velcro forever on my feet. But sometimes when we can't do something, or we're told no about something, or something seems really hard, it's not a no forever. It's not an I can't forever. Sometimes it's a wait. Sometimes we need to let our fingers get stronger and develop a little bit. And that happens as we grow. Sometimes we need to work hard to remember how to spell that word. That's still something I work on, is learning how to spell the words that are new. Sometimes we need to practice more and be patient with ourselves, because sometimes we just need to wait. It's not our time yet. And that can be really hard, because I have a feeling that you want to be able to do it right now, and to do it all by yourself, and to do it right the first time, and to score all the goals, and to get all the A's, and to feel really confident and like you can do everything. But we're still learning, and we're still growing, and we're still developing, and sometimes we just need to wait. And I can understand how frustrated that is. But here's the good news. There are so many people who are waiting with you. Your parents are waiting with you. Your coaches are waiting with you. Your teachers are waiting with you. And God is waiting with you. And as you grow and develop and learn, God is there to celebrate you when you arrive, when you spell that word right, when you tie your shoes, when you feel like your legs can actually kick a ball and it goes where you want to. All those things happen when you're ready. And so God is with you in your frustration, in your waiting, and is blessing you as you grow. And we're so excited to watch you on that journey and to encourage you when it feels like the I can't lasts forever, or the no lasts forever. Sometimes it's just a wait. And it'll be okay. Let's pray together this morning. You can repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for making me just the way I am. Thank you for loving me just the way I am. Help me to remember that sometimes I just need to wait, and that's okay. Amen.
Come and walk beside the water with me. Jesus said, come and walk with me by Sea Galilee, and I will make you fishers of men. Peter and Andrew were fishing, and they were casting their nets into the sea. When Jesus came walking by and beckoned to them, saying, come now and follow after me. Peter and Andrew considered the happy life they had led beside the sea. Now Jesus was asking them to leave it behind, and he said, come now and follow after me.
They left.
Our scripture reading is from the Gospel of Luke, the 5th chapter, verses 1 through 11. Once while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long, but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him.
Let us pray. Holy and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations in all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. For as long as I possibly could, I've ignored and avoided QAnon, refusing to even learn anything about it. But after the event at the Capitol on January 6th, my head in the sand approach felt irresponsible. And so I decided to look this thing in the face and learn something about it. According to one concise explanation I found online, QAnon is a disproven and discredited far-right conspiracy theory alleging that a secret cabal of Satan-worshipping cannibalistic pedophiles is running a global child sex trafficking ring and plotting against former U.S. President Donald Trump, who has been fighting the cabal. In other words, Nancy Pelosi, Chuck Schumer, and the like are all Satan-worshipping cannibalistic pedophiles, and the one to stop them was former President Donald Trump. Satan-worshipping cannibalistic pedophiles. Let's all take a moment to acknowledge that this is ridiculous. So ridiculous. Ridiculous, and yet has captured the hearts and minds of many Americans. A recent poll from National Public Radio in December asked people whether they believed that a group of Satan-worshipping elites who run a child sex ring are trying to control our politics and our media. 17% said it was true. And another 37% said they didn't know. That's 54% of Americans either believing in QAnon or shrugging their shoulders and saying, maybe? Maybe there's a group of Satan-worshipping elites who run a child sex ring and are trying to control our politics and media? Imagine for a moment that you believe this is true. That within our government, people are using and abusing children, drinking their blood, according to some sources. Imagine you believe this is true. Wouldn't you do everything you could to make sure this was stopped? And wouldn't it give you a really amazing sense of purpose? People want a story to give purpose to their lives. And as much as they disturb us, phenomena like conspiracy theories have something to teach us. They give people a larger story to be a part of that gives life purpose. And if you take people who are particularly spiritually bereft, without a good foundation, nothing solid to stand on, and offer these theories to them, you have a perfect combination that leads to ruined lives and ruined relationships. Conspiracy theorists tap into this part of ourselves that yearn for something bigger. Something beyond surface truth, something deeper and more exciting than our humdrum ordinary lives. And maybe sometimes you too yearn for something bigger than your ordinary humdrum life. Some are saying that this time of the coronavirus, of quarantine and isolation and anxiety, is making more and more people ask themselves, is this all there is? Our lives have become small and narrow, void of the simple pleasures of life, like grabbing a beer with friends after work, or looking forward to the next time you see your grandchildren, or planning your upcoming vacation. Life feels a little muted, boring, mundane. Is this all there is? Wouldn't it be nice to have a Satan-worshipping secret political faction to fight to give your life some purpose? Kidding. No, but our lives might feel small and narrow. And what we need is not a good conspiracy theory to get us going, but rather we need to take what sometimes feels small and narrow and go wide and deep. Most of us are realistic. We know there are no cannibalistic pedophiles running our government, just normal, ordinary, flawed people like the rest of us. Coronavirus is not a hoax. Lee Harvey Oswald shot JFK, and the dinosaurs did indeed become extinct around 65 million years ago, and climate change is indeed real. But we still might ask that question, is this all there is? We still, like all others, yearn to be a part of a bigger story. The Monday through Friday slog, the paycheck twice a month, the vacation once a year, the retirement fund, the alarm clock every morning, the evening news at night, and for those working minimum wage and barely affording rent, is this all there is? I wonder if the disciples ever asked themselves that question. I wonder if Simon Peter, one of our main characters in our gospel reading today, I wonder if he ever asked himself that question. Maybe after a night like the one he just had, of fishing all night long, throwing his net into the water over and over again, his hands calloused and rough from the haul of nets, only to pull up that net over and over again and find it empty over and over again. Did he ever wonder, is this all there is? Simon Peter is leading a quiet, ordinary life when Jesus shows up and calls him into God's great unknown story. What if Simon Peter stayed small and narrow that day? What if he never cast his net into the deep waters? What if his own feelings of unworthiness kept him back? Remember what he says when he sees the net overflowing with fish. He says, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man, not worthy." And what if Jesus had never been able to reply, "Do not be afraid. What if Simon Peter had played small? Who am I to be called? And never followed Christ? Or consider this. What if Simon Peter simply shrugged at the net full of fish and said to himself cynically, "Oh, that was just a coincidence. There's nothing special about this Jesus guy. There is nothing godlike in his presence. Life doesn't work that way. God doesn't call fishermen like me. No, fishermen like me have boring, ordinary lives of catching fish, bringing it to market, and providing for our families." In other words, what if Simon Peter failed to notice God breaking into this ordinary, everyday life? God in this ordinary, everyday life. What if the story he told himself about his normal, small, narrow life eclipsed the new story God was offering him of a life that would be wide and deep, big and rich, a life of risk and challenge and purpose? And don't we do that all the time? Don't you and I, all of us, do that all the time? God calls us and we don't notice. Because God doesn't always show up in angels descending from the heavens singing alleluias. No, God shows up in a good haul of fish, a good day's work. God doesn't call us to fight governmental vampires who are eating children, but rather to care for the children in our own school district and make sure they have enough to eat. God doesn't always show up in an earth-shaking boom or a lightning crash, but more often in an encounter with an everyday, ordinary stranger, and we don't notice because our lives have become too small and narrow. We overlook our God-infused reality all the time. God calls us in silence, and we expect it on a flashing neon sign, and so we miss it altogether. People want a story to give purpose to their lives, and this story is all around us, but most of the time, we don't notice. Much more captivated by conspiracy theories or the American dream of acquiring wealth and possessions. And while there is nothing wrong with that, that is not why God made you. We want the excitement of fighting Satan worshipers instead of doing the hard work of understanding someone who disagrees with you ideologically. We can live in our world and live lives that are deep and expansive, that see the world inspired by God's hand and alive with the Spirit. Or we can be spiritually dead to it. Eyes closed, hearts closed, shut off. And in fact, most of us live some of the time in both places, sometimes seeing it and sometimes forgetting to look. In his exceptional book, Food and Faith, A Theology of Eating, Norman Wirzba writes about this modern malaise of living in our world and being spiritually dead to it. He writes that we can grow to view the world as consisting of material entities or varied chemical nutrients that are themselves dead, and thus essentially bereft of all goodness and beauty. The world, he writes, in this view, simply is a collection of random and accidental things. Rowan Williams, the former Archbishop of Canterbury, has described this malaise as the departure of the sacred from our world. The world without the sacred, he writes, is not just disenchanted, but deprived of some kind of depth. This is a flat and boring world in which things have significance primarily in terms of their ability to satisfy an ego's desire. Things are what we take them to be. They have no integrity of their own, no sacred core or center. Rather than being icons that open to a greater world of significance and meaning. Creatures are reduced to idols that reflect the aspirations, hopes, fears, and designs of people. This is a depthless world. The departure of the sacred from the world, but of course, the sacred has not departed. We've just become a bit rusty at seeing it. Einstein said, there are two ways to live your life. One is as though nothing is a miracle, and the other is as though everything is a miracle. God calls us into a big life. God calls us to be alive, not just half alive, but fully, all the way alive. God's Spirit calls us to risk. And what is riskier than love? God calls us to follow him on a journey of true living into expansiveness and depth and struggle and challenge and amazing joy. Think about what Simon Peter was getting into. Seeing the world alive with the good news of God's love for all people and all of creation. Following Jesus as he taught and healed others, starting the church, preaching the gospel, and following Jesus to the cross and beyond. Friends, on those days when we look around and everything seems kind of gray and muted, and we wonder, is this all that there is? What we need to do is throw our nets into deeper water, to look deeper, to think deeper, to ponder and pay attention to the holy and sacred in our lives, to look beyond the shallow surface. They are not ordinary. You are not ordinary. You are a miracle. God is calling you. Yes, you, to find purpose in this phase of your life, to find the call in the ordinary that surrounds us. God is calling us into bigness, a life lived in full color, not muted, but volume turned up, and all of us alive with God's animating spirit and God's love. People want a story that gives purpose to their lives, and we have one. Our story calls us to love each other, to forgive and ask forgiveness, to fight for the poor and oppressed, to call out the false narratives of our times, to examine our own souls, to live in radical trust, not in our bank accounts or our accumulated wealth, but in God. Jesus is calling. Let us cast our nets into that deep, mysterious water and see where this beautiful story will lead us. Live a life that sizzles and pops with purpose and meaning. Be alive, fully alive, and see the sacred handiwork of God all around. It is there if we have eyes to see. It is there if we are willing to go past the surface and the shallow into the very depths of where God is calling. Amen.
Thank you, Ralph, for that wonderful creative meditation. Nice to see four of you all playing together. Friends, we have come to a time in our worship where we are sharing our joys and concerns. The best way to do that is to write it down in our chat box, and Pastor Riley and I will see it. I want us to remember that today is Chuck Kohiser's birthday, which is very exciting. Chuck, if you're listening, happy birthday to you. We love you. We're so glad you're alive, and our church loves you. You're incredibly important. So happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Chuck.
We also want to remember that Mary Jane Ellis had skin cancer removed this week. And so we pray for Mary Jane that all is going well for her as she recovers, and that all will continue to go well. Any other prayers, Pastor Riley, that we know about?
Jane Horan continues to ask for prayers for her roommate, Jackie, who is still in the hospital and can't seem to test negative for COVID. So we pray for Jackie, we pray for Jane, and for all those who are in care facilities that can't leave their room or getting sick or, that's a dire situation.
Absolutely.
Joy Lofsted, you are 8 today. Happy birthday, Joy.
Happy birthday, Joy.
You and Chuck are just about the same age.
Seeing lots of messages of happy birthday to Chuck. So Chuck, you should know that lots of people are wishing you happy birthday, and lots of people are also saying wow to Ralph and what a wonderful job he did as well.
Pam Lipkin asked prayers for her friend Tom, who's getting a stem cell transplant. Carol Medeiros, prayers for more vaccines. Absolutely. Here's hoping that the current administration will be more organized and green light more vaccines. Prayers for Barbara Florschak as she continues through treatment. Marianne O'Donnell, prayers for Ethiopia and the Russian people expressing truth to power and for those in our nation. Jeremy Dale Connell, it's your birthday. That you're celebrating today because you share it with Jesus. So, you know, good job splitting that up.
Kristen Oaks, I will be praying for this. Her sister is trying to buy the house next door, which makes me jealous because I would love for my sister to be able to live next door to me. But so there's a final walkthrough today and closing tomorrow for her sister. So we'll pray that all that goes really smoothly so you all can be neighbors and the cousins can be neighbors. That's awesome.
We are extending a prayer of gratitude for immigration policy that is changing. May implementation be swift, and may paths be understandable. May we have a system that's actually intended to work.
Safe trips to Utica, Albany, Syracuse, Plattsburgh, all the places that so many of our seniors are going and traveling to get their vaccines. Of course, Jamie Gustafson says prayers for all suffering with COVID. I think a lot of you know that my family has recovered wonderfully and we feel incredibly lucky. Kim writes prayers of concerns and love for the family and friends who have lost their beloved ones this week and over so many weeks. Prayers for friends Matt and Dennis, both very sick with COVID. Prayers for our new administration. Kathy writes for her extended family. They lost their dear cousin Julie this week. So sorry for your loss, Kathy. Thank you to Robin Leary for making beautiful music even when we have technological problems. I know there were some issues this week. So thank you, Robin, and all of our musicians for persevering. Prayers for David True, who's recovering in the hospital. This is the husband of Muriel True, so saying he's getting better.
Prayers for Kim Weir's friend Sarah, who is in hospice and will leave her the earthly world this week. May her life and all those lost inspire us to live fully and beautifully. Prayers for her and her family in this transition. Absolutely. My friends, I think we are ready to pray. I invite you, wherever you are, to take your hands, rub them together, create some heat, and put your hands wherever you need a little love. For me, it's my lower back. And just pay attention to your body. Prayer is an embodied act. So where, if it's you have a heartache or a headache or neck, wherever your body needs a little extra warmth and love this morning, I invite you to give some attention to that and to embody this prayer as we pray together this morning. Let us pray. Most holy and triune God, we come before you, a people who have a little extra hope this day. A hope for our immigrant brothers and sisters. A hope for our queer siblings. A hope for Indigenous peoples. A hope for all those who have a Black or brown body. A hope in truth and in normalcy. Lord, may we continue to hold our leaders accountable. May we continue to advocate